Good morning, everyone. Morning, my European friends. I have to say, before we start, that today is a really sad day for millions of us in the UK because it's the day we're leaving Europe. And I just want to reiterate that there are literally millions of us that are absolutely devastated, heartbroken, angry. We think it's the stupidest thing our country has ever done. So I may be moving to Tartu. So before I begin, I'm just going to talk a little bit about my background, where I come from, what I've done, and then I'll move into a little bit about what I've learned. Fantastic presentations this morning. I've been really, really inspired. So thank you guys so much for putting on this wonderful event. I started a degree in journalism in 2005 in London. And they were teaching me newspaper journalism only. Things like shorthand when I had a dictaphone on my iPhone. And I thought, hold on a minute, this isn't right. You know, I'm learning skills that are not going to prepare me for the world of work. When I graduate university, I'm going to be working in digital, not print. So I Googled organizations in London that could give me relevant digital training in journalism. Nothing existed. So I thought, right, I'm going to set up an organization that gives students and graduates paid experience in digital. And it was called newspaper.com. It was my first startup, and it took off like wildfire. We were hiring, we had about 250 students on our books within a year. We were producing content for brands like Facebook, Twitter, PayPal. And the reason why it took off is because we were the first production company in London doing content for the internet. And that was when I really got my bug for technology and startups. I just saw the transformation, how it could transform lives. I was networking within the London technology community and meeting all these incredible entrepreneurs who one day had an idea in their head, and the next day they'd got £20 million in funding and were building this amazing technology that was changing people's lives. From there, I started producing content for TechCrunch, which is kind of like a publication for technology news. And then I really got the Silicon Valley bug. And I kept writing stories about entrepreneurs from Silicon Valley, researching about Silicon Valley, how it was the mecca of tech where everybody and their dog was doing a startup and I had to get there. So in 2009, I persuaded the Next Web, which is kind of like the Dutch TechCrunch, to give me a job as Silicon Valley video director for the Next Web. So I got on a plane, flew over to Silicon Valley, and was running around Silicon Valley with my video camera, interviewing people like Mark Zuckerberg, the founder of Facebook, and the founders of Airbnb and Uber, when their companies only had 4 or 5 people and were still working out of a co-working space. In fact, for the Uber interview, my editor called me up and he said, Hermione, can you go and interview this startup guy? He's got this startup called Uber Taxi. And I was really hungover. And I was like, oh, it's probably another startup. It's not going to fail. I'm not going to go to the interview. So I rocked up. It was this guy in a co-working space, 4 employees. And I was really not with it. But obviously, I'm so amazed and glad that I managed to get out of bed that day, because now Uber, you know, it's a household name. Do you guys have Uber here, right, in Estonia? Yeah. So, and that gave me even more the startup bug, meeting entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley who, again, one day had an idea in their head, and you think, ah, it's not a good idea. And the next day, it's a global brand and it's technology that's being used by people all over the world. So one thing led to another, and I did a TV show in America called Silicon Valley. It was a $25 million TV show. They followed the lives of 6 of us who were trying to build startups in San Francisco. Amazing experience. The takeaway there is, although we're at a digital conference and we talk about the power of digital, TV is very much still a very powerful medium. if you get a chance to do a TV show as a startup, you should definitely do it, because we got our technology in across 91 million homes in America, and all we had to do is prance around on TV for a few months. So it was definitely worth it, definitely worth the exposure. From then, I got the startup bug, and I did a couple of startups in San Francisco. I was co-founder of Vibes, which was the world's first smart vibrator. From there, I sort of one thing led to another in my personal life, and I had my first child out in San Francisco. And the US healthcare system, just after I'd given birth, gave me a bill for $50,000. And I thought, I cannot live in this country. I cannot bring up children in this country. So I asked my partner to move back to the UK about 3.5 years ago, and here we are. At that point, my startup Vibes was in some financial difficulties. We raised $500,000 previously, but we couldn't raise another round of funding, and so we couldn't do some more R&D and build a new line of hardware products. And a friend of mine recommended me for a role as head of communications at Tinder, and I jumped at the chance. So I joined in about 2015. At the time that I joined, Tinder was already a household name. And I'm just going to talk a little bit about how Tinder launched and got successful, first of all. Does anyone not know what Tinder is? Oh, that's good. A lot of Tinder users here. Put your hand up if you've actually used Tinder. Okay. Just a few. I'm sure there's more than that. Maybe some people aren't too keen on disclosing that information. So when Tinder launched, they got ambassadors on each of the Ivy League campuses in America. And they gave them a small marketing budget. And they threw these amazing parties across campuses in America. And you were only allowed into the party if you showed that you had downloaded Tinder's app on your phone. So again, a great marketing strategy. Throw a party, you can only get in if you have our app on your phone. And from there, the product really PR'd and marketed itself. And that's another takeaway. If you have an incredible product that gamifies dating or gamifies an industry or makes it fun to use, it will spread like wildfire. So that's why I call it product PR and marketing. You know, when you're sitting down and you're developing products, you need to think about the functionality and how people use it from the very, very start. I work for a lot of startups now, and they build too many features into their products. Simplify, simplify, simplify. Okay, so when I joined Tinder in 2015, they were like, Hermione, you know, we're a household name here, but we have quite a few bad headlines written about us. We have a little bit of an image problem in Europe. Can you help us? So I did three big campaigns whilst I worked at Tinder. The first was an incredible campaign with the National Health System in England. So they came to us and they said, look, 11,000 people have died last year because they couldn't get a donation for an organ in the 18 to 35 age group. You guys have millions of users in the 18 to 35 age group. Can you help us? So we ran this amazing campaign where for a two-week period, if you were swiping through the app, a celebrity profile card would pop up and it would say, it's a match, if only it was this easy to get an organ donation match. And it had a link to sign up to donate your organs. And when we launched the campaign, it went viral. As you can see, here's an article on the BBC. It was reported in every news outlet in the world, from BBC to Daily Mail. And it was the biggest driver in the sign-up for people to donate their organs that the NHS had ever had. Huge amounts of power, huge amounts of success, and that's one thing that I'm very, very passionate about, technology for good. And I guess the takeaway here is I think we're living in a time now where consumers want good. We're living in extremely turmoil times politically. And I think if you can find a good use for your technology and have a social or environmental angle to your technology, you should talk about that in the press. So the campaign with the NHS was very, very successful in terms of changing brand perceptions. You know, a few weeks before this campaign, the headlines around Tinder had been, Tinder blamed for rise in STDs amongst millennials. And we were having to put out statements from our CEO saying, this wasn't true, yada, yada, yada. But then we came on and we did these social campaigns that really changed the brand image of Tinder. Secondly, we did a political engagement around the EU referendum. So as you can see here, we did another two-week campaign where when people used Tinder, they were shown a quiz that would take them through a series of questions and show them if their views were more aligned with Brexit or Remain. And again, there was a driver for a sign-up for them to register to vote. And it was the biggest sign up again to register for vote in the millennial age group that the British political campaign had ever had. Thirdly, we wanted to change our reputation. Where's the time thing? Oh, here we go. Thirdly, we wanted to change our reputation from a hookup app to something more meaningful. So it was my job to go around Europe and find all the Tinder babies across Europe. Anyone here have a Tinder baby? Woohoo! Yes, round of applause. So let's just think about that for a moment. A piece of technology has enabled you to make life. That is incredible, and that's why I love the technology industry. So it was my job to go around Europe and find all the couples that had met and got married and then had babies from Tinder, or not got married, just had babies, from Tinder, and then resell those stories in the press. And again, it was a hugely successful campaign, press campaign. We had coverage on news outlets, press outlets all over the world. And it really changed the brand perception of Tinder from a hookup app to something that was more meaningful. You didn't name your baby Tinder, did you? Okay, that's good. So what's the takeaway here? So as I said, we are living in incredibly intense, crazy times politically. And I often think our media and our technology is a reflection of the times we're living in. I did some research last year and found out that 4,951 new startups launched daily. That's just the iOS store. So the competition is absolutely huge. And when I'm talking to my clients, I say, we have to really think outside of the box here. We have to be really clever. We have to give our brand values. And there is just literally so much competition that you really have to think differently. At Tinder, a lot of our PR and marketing was data-led. So by the time I joined in 2015, Tinder was already a household name. And I was on the PR and marketing team for 91 million swipes per day. And at that time, there had been 11 billion swipes on the app to date. So at Tinder, we had huge data sets from millions of users. So what we would do is we would try to analyze these data sets, and then we would try to sell that data as a partnership. So I'm going to give you an example of a partnership here with Gillette. So we looked at our data sets, and we found that women swipe right more on profiles of men without beards. Sorry, guys in the room with beards. I'm looking at you. I think it's sexy. So we went to Gillette and we ran this incredible marketing campaign with them. I'm going to show you the video now. And Gillette.
In this swipe or die world, your face is all you got. So how do you make a good first impression when you only have about 2 seconds? Only one way to find out. Girls talking about guys behind their backs about their faces and what should or should not be growing on them. They said things like,
I mean, I'm not into like a lot of facial hairs, so
if it's like long, I'm like, zip. Ew, like what is that?
You gotta shave that. Just stop it. If it's like weird and
So Tinder, the experts of first impressions, got together with Gillette to see if the numbers backed up what we heard. They did a series of tests with over 100,000 random guys, analyzed their faces, their matches, and right versus left swipes. The verdict? 74% of right swipes went to guys who kept their facial hair in check. The girls were like,
he looks better in this picture.
Yeah, like he's cute there.
Dude, he's beautiful though.
So there you go. When girls talk about guys behind their backs about their faces, one thing is brutally clear.
If you can pull it, then yeah, swipe left.
So Gillette paid us for Tinder a lot of money for that campaign. And I guess my takeaway here is partnerships and data are an incredible way to grow your brand. You know, if you have data sets within your users, within your company, try to extract trends and then turn those trends into PR and marketing stories, put them out in the press, create media, and it's a great way to firstly create revenue, bring in some extra money, and secondly to cross-fertilize your brand with that other brand. So I said data is really, really important, and you know, we're living in a time where we're all creating a lot of data on a daily basis. Our data is being sold for billions of dollars worldwide. And yes, data is important. But I still think the most important thing is story. If your company doesn't have a good story from the beginning, and then it won't survive, not in this day and age. Oh.
If people say your dreams are crazy.
Hang on, can you just pause it?
If they laugh at what you think you can do.
Can you pause it?
Good.
Sorry, I just didn't realize I didn't explain this. So the guy talking in this video is Colin Kaepernick, who is an American football player. And at the time, he actually knelt down on one knee to protest against Trump's treatment of immigrants. And it was a hugely political statement from this football player. And within 2 weeks, Nike, massive brand, had turned around this campaign and they'd put it out in the news and it had gone viral. And I think if you look on YouTube now, it has millions of views. So if you just start the video again.
If people say your dreams are crazy, if they laugh at what you think you can do, good. Because calling a dream crazy is not an insult, it's a compliment. Don't try to be the fastest in your school. Be the fastest ever. Don't believe you have to be like anybody to be somebody. Don't become the best basketball player on the planet. Be bigger than basketball. Believe in something, even if it means sacrificing everything. If you have only one hand, don't just watch football, play. And if you're a girl from Compton, become the greatest athlete ever. Yeah, that's more like it. So don't ask if your dreams are crazy. Ask if they're crazy enough.
So a hugely political campaign for Nike. And I think this is the way brand marketing is going. It's getting political, it's getting environmental, it's getting social. And if you're not political, environmental, and social, or you don't have those brand themes in your product, in your story, you won't survive because, as I said, media and technology are a reflection of our times, and we have some pretty big problems of our times. And if your brand doesn't align with those or reflect those or take a stance on a political problem, then it will not survive. For example, plastics. Microplastics are a huge problem, as we all know. many brands now are getting behind this and launching products or campaigns to eliminate microplastics and unnecessary packaging. For example, in the UK, one of our biggest department stores, John Lewis, just before Christmas, ran a huge marketing campaign around paper crackers and having paper or wooden toys inside and eliminating plastic. So this is something to think about when you're building your product, when you're building your technology. You know, think about the political stance you're going to take. You know, what value, what benefit to the environment or climate is your product or service going to make. So that's pretty much it. I've got a few minutes left for questions, and thank you very much.
Very good. Very interesting work there. Very relevant, I think, the day-to-day, the focus on the good, the focus on the purpose that we all need, focus on the story. Can you give us some insight into, I mean, focusing on the story? This is like, can we talk a little bit more about that for a moment? Like, okay, I run a company, we're a bunch of guys, we put it together. Like, do we need to like dig inside of ourselves and find that story? Or do we sort of need to make up something larger? Like, what are some of your experiences with companies like, we don't know a story, what's our story?
I think 10 years ago when I started, it wasn't so important to share your personal story as a CEO and founder. Because there wasn't so much competition. But now, you know, on the one side, we're living in such a competitive market. On the other side, there's so much noise out there that to cut through the noise and to really reach people, you need to share your personal story. There's a new mental health startup, a mental health app in London that's just launched. And the founders have shared their story on Facebook, just doing little videos with their iPhones, sharing their journey, building this startup. And it's been really, they share the downs as well as the ups, and I think that's really important. And it's been really interesting to see them, you know, build this store, start up, raise some funding, then they spent too much, then they had to cut staff, then they got to hire again, you know. So it's really been really interesting to follow them on this amazing journey.
How do you, okay, sure, the ups and the downs of the journey is important. I think on some sort of logical level, we can understand that. But then you approach a management board, the CEO, and you go, hey, you know that thing that you didn't do really well that was really embarrassing and you think wasn't a good thing for the company? I want you to talk about it. Is that difficult sometimes in practice to get them to truly get the authentic story out?
Yeah, I mean, at Tinder, we had to put out a lot of statements from our CEO, you know, explaining the reason why there was a headline about Tinder or about how people abuse the community. And in every community, most people will be good users, but there are always a few users who try and abuse the system. And there are a few times where he also made a few public gaffes in the PR when we tried to tell him to put out a good story on why. So, yeah, I think now more than ever, you really have to think about what you're saying and think about the story that you're putting out.
Is that, I mean, okay, the public gaffes from, I mean, pretty much everyone these days, and we live in times where you say one word off and bam, it's all on you on social media and all through the media. I mean, is that specific coaching that is now being given to management? And I guess at like what level do you start to think about that specific coaching? You know, probably we're all going to say something stupid at some stage, but
I think it's really nuanced. You know, a few years ago, the kind of saying everything online of what you thought was very popular, sharing every little detail. Now I think we're entering a new phase of media and social media. Where, you know, people aren't sharing as much about sort of every little detail, and they're sharing more thoughtfully, and the posts that are getting the most traction now are actually the stories of failure, of actresses and actors or CEOs dealing with brain tumors or sickness, or, you know, being fucking real, because life is tough, and you know, not everything is rainbow and unicorns, and building a startup is going to be the hardest thing you'll ever do in your life. So, you know, share the bad and the good, because it is going to be bad. That's just human nature and human life.
Okay, so it's something sort of this transition phase. I mean, we're all learning how to use social media. Let's face it, we don't all quite know yet as individuals and a society how this should all fit. And okay, you're saying rather than getting attention by being provocative, which maybe is what we used to do. Oh, here's my edgy thoughts that I've been thinking, I'm going to say them. Now it's, you know, share that real fragility,
empathy.
Share that empathy, share those real stories of failure. And that is actually the angle that's hitting these days.
Exactly. Is that the landscape has definitely changed in the last couple of years.
All right, very good. We're out of time, unfortunately. Please, one more round of applause for Hermione Way. Thank you, ma'am.